Okay, we are recording. This is January, what is it, the 10th? Yeah. This is our first D&D Climate Action Network second year, 2.0. So Marty, why don't you get us going?
Okay, so I know Linda's or I have had conversations with, I think, each of you, so you probably know a lot of the backstory for, we've alternately called this, you know, the kitchen crew or kitchen cabinet, or this is DDCAN 2.0. And I'll just rehash a couple things. The team of us, there were five of us originally that launched the first year and organized all those meetings. And when we kind of got ready to plan the second year, we had learning. And I just want to share three things at the top of my head. One of the learnings was that while a lot of people showed up, it didn't exactly pop like a network in terms of self-organizing, you know, if we were thinking of it as a network. And part of it was that we really felt responsible for having a great program every time people got into conversation, and we're kind of owning it in a way that we felt actually worked against building a network. So that was one insight. The other insight was, there was so much interest at first, a lot of people coming in and out, and pretty big numbers of people in the room, 20 people maybe, 15, 25, that intimacy or really engaging in nitty-gritty conversations was a little hard. And there was also a lot of diversity of people in the room, and not everyone were process people. There were people just drawn to climate action, and they wanted to find a home to talk about some things. So, and then the third thing is that we found a couple times in our little planning meetings, because we'd have one or two or three even planning meetings before every single call, but sometimes we'd get into these extremely meaningful sharings of what we're doing and talking about some of the issues we're facing and some of the ways we're trying to express our skills in dealing with climate. And a light bulb would go up and would say, this is why we wanted to do this. What we're doing right now is why we wanted to do the Climate Action Network. So kind of out of that spirit came the idea of it. Let's try it a second way, and let's start a little smaller, and let's start with people that we already know have taken a dive into climate work, come out of some type of a process background as well. And that's kind of how we got to all of us being on this call. And there's a little larger crew of us that have been invited for this initial part of this first phase. And then the last thing I'll say about the kitchen idea is just the wanting to have some sort of playful, evocative metaphor for our work. So we kind of came up with the house idea, and we thought of, you know, where's the room in the house where you get together with a small group of people and you're really having those conversations. So we kind of said, well, we're going to start with our kitchen crew or our kitchen cabinet. So
There's nobody here in this kitchen but me, but you're in the kitchen.
In the kitchen, right. Some of us are in our quasi-kitchen in our office. So so any other insights, Linda, on that? Or any of you all experienced what we did last year. So what resonated, or any other thoughts you have about being in this room now, just before we start our opening sharing? Anybody?
Well, the only thing that I might add, do you hear me okay with this microphone? The only thing that I might add is just that, you know, we're not opposed to growing it over time. In fact, we'd like it to grow, but I think we all came to the conclusion that let's just start small, really, and create a solid foundation amongst, you know, those of us who want to start this again, you know, and find a format that really nourishes us, you know, that because if we feel nourished, then we'll have something that we can share with other people that will also nourish. So I think that's really the spirit in which we're wanting to move forward. So anybody else? Jim, we don't hear you.
Nope. Jim.
No?
Now.
Yes. So what about the results of the NCDDD conference in October? Does that influence our redoing and so on?
Not so much. We had actually had conversations with most of the participants over the summer. And what we decided really did come out of that, though I think we all felt very good about what we did at the conference. Yeah, we and I did get some good feedback. So I think, you know, that was a very wonderful offering we made to NCDB.
Just commenting on Marty's summary of the learnings, they sound, they make sense to me in light of my experience last year. Often our check-ins took up 2/3 of the time, so there was little opportunity to really go deeper. And with a shifting cast of characters, a large shifting cast of characters, it was hard to get much traction, although the conversations always had some, you know, some value. But I liked what I read about the learnings and like starting small. And I'm not sure what it would take to feel nourished, but I'm, you know, really wanted to, I put priority on showing up to the opportunity was. And Sarah, just to acknowledge, you and I have met virtually through a conversation a couple of years ago at the Public Conversation, what was it called, the Public Conversations Project. So I was in the room and you attended virtually. I don't know if you remember that. But,
exactly.
Jim Lee.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
I was going to mention that I haven't been part of the conversation so far. So
yeah.
I'm very glad to meet all of you. And I have had extensive conversations with Linda. So I feel like I've been brought up to speed to some extent.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of background noise that's making it hard to hear. I'm not sure where it's coming from.
Oh, you know, I'm going to mute myself. It's probably me.
Yes, it was.
Yeah, okay.
I was just going to, one other reflection, and this is something that sort of Grady and I share, though this may not be Grady's reflection. It isn't, of course. There is a kind of push-pull around when you have, as you were working last year in this case, to make sure that there was some topic, some interesting speaker on the calls. And I have to admit that, again, there were some times where I showed up because of that person or that topic that pulled me in. When it was just a random group to me, a relatively random group of NCDD types, and I didn't really have, and there was no glue there yet. The topic alone pulled me in. Grady and I are working on trying to create something in Massachusetts around the Elders Climate Action. And again, I think we focus on the need to have a topic and a speaker to bring people to our meetings. And sometimes we're, you know, it's like, well, how do we use that time best to do the work we need to do together as a group? Now, that's not supposed to be a dialogue group. That's supposed to be an action group. But it's a continued puzzle to me. I don't have an answer. You know,
right.
Sometimes I'm pulled in by the topic, and at least I suppose until there's enough closeness that it's just being in the presence of these other people enough, that's sufficient, perhaps.
I think that's what we wanted to test out, is if we can get to know each other better and see how we are resources to each other, or support people to each other. Does that add value to our work or not? Is that, and I have some reasons why I'm searching for that, and because I'm not finding it in other places where I'm doing this work. I'm very supported in some ways, but there's a piece of me that's not supported that I just sense maybe you all, because you come from some similar backgrounds, might get the things I think about and do. So we can get into that more. I mean, I told Linda earlier that because of the election and what's going on, I have just a lot of thoughts on my mind that I'm trying to struggle through. And I know we've got these questions that we want to get into as we start this conversation. But I'm wondering if the first question, where we share a little bit about our background, whether with only this number of people, we each could talk for, I don't know, 4 minutes or, you know, something. I don't know what we want to do here. But we could maybe leave it a little up to the person as to maybe to just raise some things that are on their minds right now in doing this work. Is that fair game? As well as just an introductory. Does that make sense? See a few head nods.
Yeah, sure.
Because I think Linda set up three questions that we ideally will get through, and we can, you know, we can let it flow. So Linda, do you want to say anything else? Are we ready for kind of a...
Yeah, I'm good to go. I think we can keep this as loose as we want to. You know, we're few people, so I don't care if we even follow the little questions that we have over here on the left. That's, you know, that's fine. Actually, I don't even mind. Ashley, let's get Jim to share, only because I know his time is short. And Jim, because your time's short, if you want to say anything about, you know, format, anything about the other questions, why don't you feel free to kick things off?
Okay. So what I'd like to do is just tell you about some activities that I'm involved in right now, and also what I like out of the Fabulous Network. And as you know, I'm sort of a faith-based guy, and I'm working with the Unitarian Congregation in Exeter. And we have been pursuing Active Hope, Joanna Macy's, and we've done a good job of doing that. And I am focusing now on the third aspect of the spiral of the work that reconnects of Macy's, and that's seeing with new eyes. And especially planetary thinking and planetary boundaries. I'm trying to figure out how to extend that, my learning, into process-related activities. And so in light of that, I'm taking a MOOC course from Stockholm, which is extraordinary, and it's called Planetary Boundaries and Human Opportunities. And I plan to take Jeffrey Sachs' course on sustainable development in September. So there are two beautiful things about planetary level thinking. And from a process point of view, how do I go about it in a religious and community setting is my question. Item two, we had Tim DeChristopher of the nonviolent communication fame at our church in December. He took us through a five-step process of really appreciative inquiry in terms of helping us as a congregation move forward. And it's interesting that he travels with a musician at all times, and there were a lot of folk songs and which are superb. And he's graduating as a UU minister in June from the Harvard Divinity School. And finally, I'm intrigued with Tom Peters' latest book because he spends a big hunk of the book on Mother Nature. Mother Nature being one of three major forces that are shaping the future. Not only that, he takes the aspects of Mother Nature, like diversity and emergence and those kinds of things, and lays it out as a political agenda for those of us interested. So there are three things that have struck me, and I'm working on and trying to work on. Now, what do I want from our kitchen cabinet? I want ideas on content and process. I want conversation with peers. I do feel kind of alone. I'd like to make a contribution to the field like we did in October at the biennial. Maybe a project we might be interested in is a guide to facilitating sustainable development sessions, that kind of possible project. And I am, and we might plan to do something for the conference in 2018 as a goal, a contribution goal. And finally, I'm interested in faith-based learning in action. That's it. Wow. That killed the conversation.
Just in case you have to drop off, Jim, that was great. Do you have any issues with this being a monthly meeting and this date on time being good?
Yeah, time is good except for the third Tuesday or whatever it is. Because
so the third Tuesday is not good for you.
It's exactly when we have our school board meeting.
Okay.
This is the second Tuesday. That's what we're doing now. Okay.
What do we got here? I can't find my calendar. Sorry.
Well, we're on scheduling. Is Monday out of the question?
Not for me.
Same time?
I could do a Monday. Mm-hmm. Monday in some way.
It's better for me. Except for once a month, like Jim. So we probably all have got some.
I like Monday idea.
The second Monday we're looking at?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that could work for me.
The only time it wouldn't, I think, is, at least if I think about it, is if we have like a holiday weekend or something or other and you're not, you know.
Right.
Yeah, and we could either skip that one or
right.
If we need to reschedule it, but.
I'm okay Mondays.
Second Monday is great.
Okay.
All right. We can switch it to the second Monday of the month. Okay. Well, thanks, Jim, for your offers.
Jim, before you go, I have to ask you one quick question. I don't know if this is allowed because I'm breaking into our check-in. Was that Fred Small that Tim brought?
Oh, gosh. I just think it is, yes.
Fred Small?
A younger guy, wonderful beard, tall. Is that? No.
No,
it wasn't Fred Small. No, it wasn't. I know who Fred Small.
Okay, never mind. Okay.
Okay.
Actually, Jim, I have a question for you, too. If I'm interested in your MOOC, how would I find it? Could you maybe send me a link or?
I will send you a link. It's University of Stockholm, and they speak beautifully English. And it's at SGI. Anyhow, I'll send it to you.
Great.
To all of us, if you can just hit, because I was going to kind of track it down. Too, and maybe just look at the syllabus for it or something.
They have three courses and they're extraordinary, really.
Great.
So maybe I could type it in here somehow.
Oops.
That works.
Yeah.
That would be great if you could just put it maybe under that, under all those questions.
I think we all can type. Great.
Sure.
Yeah, so after that inspirational start, who wants to kind of tell us a little bit about what they're doing, where they've been, and what they're thinking about for this group?
I'm sort of hanging back to hear more about how we're doing it before I...
Okay. Well, I will talk. I mean, Jim just blew me away. But I just was so entranced with just about everything he said. And it just shows me what a reset moment I'm in. I had made this little jot that I'm in the midst of a reset on my work, triggered by the election and being kind of surprised that I'm doing well. And I just really kind of got knocked off balance greatly. I was already reading my climate work, but that just kind of thrust open a whole bunch of other things for me. So I'm allowing myself some time right now to be confused on where to put my time and even just how to think about some things. And I can give you some example. But by way of background, for about 4 years, I have a background mainly in facilitation and mainly in technology of participation facilitation methods, and a great arena where I love to use that work is in systems thinking or strategic thinking. So I'm a real context person. I like to kind of make sure that if I'm working with people, that there's a shared context or that we're working for a common frame of understanding. And for 4 years now, I've really spent most of my time doing climate work, and I started really focusing on, and it's been mostly political organizing and community organizing and related to Citizens Climate Lobby. I went through the climate reality training. And so I've done public speaking, a lot of lobbying. I lead a chapter of Citizens Climate Lobby. I lead a national team on climate and environmental justice in Citizens Climate Lobby that's seeking to build alliance and support for climate and environmental justice work. But over the last couple of years, I've slowly migrated to want to network more at state climate action and local climate action. So now I've developed quite a network in the state of California. And in California, our climate package of legislations and regulations is under review right now. There's still strong commitment to it, but there's kind of this window for more citizen input. I decided to get involved there. And then locally, I've also made connections primarily with the faith community and the sustainability work that's being done by local government. And the main roles I've played are organizer, kind of organizational capacity builder and organizer, outreach person, and then also donating my skills. For example, I'm helping the county of Contra Costa, which is where I live, create a sustainability exchange where they're bringing all the government employees that work on sustainability throughout the county from any government entity, whether it's a city or the county itself or regional bodies that work in the county, bringing them together to form a network, a sustainability exchange, so that they can leverage their work. So I've just kind of, I wear my professional hat there and just show up and just help them design and lead things. So what I've run into in my roles in working organizationally, like with Citizens Climate Lobby, is kind of where I've experienced some of the rubs around feeling alone. And that's because I find that a lot of groups, bless their hearts, they're really effective, but they also start with a lot of assumptions. You know, so you're suddenly in a meeting or you're suddenly hearing that something needs to happen, and there's no, I just see assumptions sprouting everywhere. You know, I want to ask the underlying question, why are we doing this? Back up, why do we think this is the best way? Similarly, there's not a lot of skill for inclusion of people in conversations. So I've noticed it's pretty uneven how well people are included in doing different actions within the organization. And work is really fast, and so there's very little time for reflection and learning. And so I feel like I bring all of those desires when I do my work. Can we slow down and kind of try to look underneath? Let's step back a minute and think about what we're doing. And sometimes I'm really successful, and sometimes I just fail miserably at this, and people get kind of irritated with me in doing that work. So that's a little bit of background. I really feel like I don't have quite the focus in the hearing that I'm doing now that Jim brought about resources or where I'm going, because I really am not sure. I'm really questioning all the work I'm doing right now, political work, to be honest. You know, and when I think what made my heart open up to listen to Jim is I think I'm pretty close to burnout.
Oh.
You know, I felt this yearning listening to him. It's like, I want to sit with active hope for a while. You know, I want to sit and settle into, it's okay, just let it go. I think I've kind of hung on too tight. Do you know what I mean? We're engines for change here, and I'm going to bring all these skills, and I'm going to help, and we're going to, and you know, we really don't know the territory we're in right now in terms of, politically. It's very clear locally we can still do an awful lot, but it's just really unclear how things are going to move forward. So part of the reason I'm in a reset and sitting is because the dust has to settle a little bit to know exactly what's going to happen on the political front. So I'll stop there. I've got some other issues I'm thinking about, but that gives you a sense of where I'm at. Did Jim just leave us? Did he have to? I think he did. I think he just waved goodbye.
Well, I can go. yeah, it's hard to beat Jim's quick and very succinct words. I didn't really prepare a whole lot for this because I find that yesterday and today I'm just packed with things. I was going to tell my story how I even got into sustainability work, but I think I'll save that for another time. It's a long story. On reflecting about it today, when I was taking my walk, I couldn't believe how I've been kind of into sustainability work since a child, although I had years when I wasn't. I relate a lot to what you're saying, Marty. I haven't been doing climate change work as much as I have been these last 2 years like you. I've really only really kind of thrown myself at it for the last 2 years, though before that I was putting together a wellness center that I wanted to make sustainable, and what I wanted to do with my wellness center was to bring people to it to do dialogues, and part of what I wanted to dialogue on was on climate change. So 2 years ago I had to jump back into professional work because I had IRS bills. I won't go into all the nitty-gritty of it, but it looked like I really had to earn money again, big time. I couldn't just live off my real estate that I had inherited from my parents. And so that scared me. So I thought, whoa, that means I'm going to have to go back into organization development work and facilitation. But I was at that point, I had read the Naomi Klein book, and I knew I wanted to do something around climate change and dialogue. So all I knew was I was going to somehow put those two together. And it was really going, doing that NCDD, we called it the Social Trans. It was an 8-week virtual conference that I did with Tom Attlee and Ben Roberts that really got me kind of on the path that I'm on now. And actually, Marty, I think you found me because of that.
They do.
Yeah. So we started this this network really as an outgrowth of wanting to do, at least for me, wanting to do dialogue and do it with people who were deeply engaged in climate change work. What I'm doing now, I'm a little bit at a crossroads myself, and one of the things I am looking for in a group like this is to kind of help me with these, you know, these pathways. we're always adjusting, you know, what we do out in the world, given the contingencies we face. And so I successfully made myself incredibly busy these last 2 years. What I'm doing now is I'm on the Tucson City Climate Change Committee, which is an advisory committee to the mayor and council. And on that front, they're trying to put some pressure on us to downsize. And we're going around saying, no, this is not the time to downsize. This is the time to like allow us to expand. So tomorrow, in fact, I'm meeting with one of our council people. So I have learned from that experience the hard way that nothing happens politically unless we build relationships, you know, at the level at which we're working. So my goal going forward with that work is to build relationships with the mayor, the mayor's office, with 8 council people. I'm just going to go through, meet them all, introduce myself, and keep in touch. Because if we don't know what their interest is in climate change, we can't be effective as change makers. So lots of learnings there. I'm going to keep that engagement going because even though it's been very unfruitful, I would say the last year that I've been on it, I do feel at some point my process skills can come in handy. I just haven't, you know, I haven't been there long enough. We only meet once a month for 2 hours and it hasn't had enough traction yet. But luckily, because I've been pushing for it, we just formed a governance committee. I'm on it. And so we're going to, I hope, plan a retreat once we get reorganized. And I'm hoping to use some of my process skills there. The other big thing I'm doing in Tucson is something called Architecture 2030. I know I've talked about this before. That seems to be going pretty well. In fact, I think it's probably the only thing in Tucson that's going anywhere. We've got about 30, 40 people involved with it so far. As Marty knows, I co-facilitated an action planning session in November with them. and I'm on the executive committee of that group. And it's driving me a little bit crazy because it's so all-encompassing. I mean, there's just meetings like every week. I'm finding myself to be getting too scattered. So one of my big questions is, do I stay really involved with them or do I, you know, go in different directions? The other thing that's tugging at me is I just recently launched my website and it needs all kinds of work. I haven't had time to even edit my website. So I'm being pulled actually to kind of focus more on my dialogue work and bringing it out in the world. I think I even mentioned this to you, Sarah. Next year there's going to be a gathering for people who are using BOEM dialogue in particular all over the world. It's going to be in London, and I've recently gotten involved with the head of that group, Peter Garrett from London, and I'm going to be showing him KikoChat, and he's all excited because I'm excited about getting us together sooner rather than waiting till October. Let's just start meeting virtually. So I'm going to give him a tour and his staff a tour of KikoChat next week. So that could go somewhere. I mean, we could be starting to do BOEM dialogues all over the world, or hopefully around climate change, because that is one of the issues that we're facing. So I'm very excited about that. And of course, I started a book 2 years ago, and I haven't even returned to it. So that, you know, I have this sort of this feeling inside me that I'm supposed to be doing more of the dialogue and not running around doing, you know, helping building owners reduce their carbon footprint. And yet they're both really important to do. The other thing I got involved with last year was with a group called Building Resilient Neighborhoods. And I was hoping that that was going to bear fruit more quickly. It's mainly right now an emergency preparation workshop. And I helped design it. We've taken it into some neighborhoods. I had wanted to grow that into like a neighborhood socially cohesion kind of group effort. But we need money, funding. We don't have it. And I think I'm going to let that one go because it's just too much. So trying to think if there's anything else to share. As far as what I want from the group, I think Jim really said it all. I want connections, ideas. I want to be able to have feedback that might be helpful at times like this when I'm, you know, trying to make a decision of where best to use my energies and skills. So I think that's enough for me right now.
Thank you. I'd be happy to go next. That's all right. I'm listening with a sinking feeling, to be perfectly candid. I've always wondered whether I'm a good fit for this group. And as I listen to those who've checked in so far, I would say I think not. But let me say why I think that. And I don't have to draw a conclusion today. The headline would be that I'm not looking for tools particularly or tips or techniques. I'm not engaged in dialogue facilitation, although I've done things that resemble that around climate change, you know, multi-stakeholder dialogue. But right now, my principal commitment with Rick's help is building in Massachusetts, a chapter of Elders Climate Action, this new organization of which we are the first chapter, and I'm trying to figure out how to be a leader, an activist leader, for the first time in my life, and build on my, I'd say, considerable expertise around organizational leadership and figure out how much, if any, of that transfers to organizing and trying to build a social movement. I feel myself to be more of an advocate and activist who facilitates occasion, you know, monthly chapter meetings, and then makes presentations. Rick and I are working with others on a presentation that we have given a dozen times. I'm giving one tomorrow to a local group of a community aging group, people who want to stay in their homes but are retired, who come together to monthly to hear presentations, and hoping to plant a seed that would lead them to become a group that would want to take action in some alliance with Elders Climate Action. And so I think the questions I'm struggling with, it's a different set of questions, and I don't think they're very good answers. It's sort of just kind of feel your way in. It's how do you build a social movement? And in particular, at this time in the political life of the country, where the opportunities at the federal national level seem limited, so that my work with Citizens Climate Lobby, which is in some ways the template, the model, big sister organization for Elders Climate Action, that doesn't seem promising to invest a lot of energy at that level. Although our executive director of CCL, Mark Reynolds, promises that there will be carbon pricing legislation adopted by the end of 2017. I'm not sure how he gets there. And I'd be delighted, but I don't believe it, and I'm not going to work on it. I'm intrigued by the opportunities at the state level, where I think Massachusetts, alongside with California, has the possibility to be a flagship state. And I think that we, by focusing on elders as a community to mobilize, have a chance to attract and energize a powerful constituency. They vote, they have resources, they have time. They have often a social conscience and concerned about legacy. And so that's a fertile field. But I don't think we yet have a theory of change or how to organize in a way that how to reach out that has any chance of getting us where we want to go as fast as the science tells us we need to go in order to do something that really shapes, you know, it really has an impact on policy. So there's all those challenges for which I don't know that I see this group as a resource based on just I admire what's gone into it, the thinking that Marty and Linda and others have put into it, but I'm not sure that it meets me where I feel a need. Where I feel a need is more around how do I integrate, and this builds a little bit on what Jim had to say around his spiritual approach, although I'm not affiliated with any church. I am, and I'm not even religious by any conventional sense. I consider myself a religious naturalist, if you will, a non-theist religious person with a longstanding, you know, 40 plus year meditation practice that's Buddhist influenced. And I'm wondering, I'm sitting with the question, how do I bring my own spiritual and personal development into my engagement with climate change in a way that's synergistic? So I met with for the first time with the local monthly group that I've been hearing about this morning at the local Insight Meditation Center. There's an elders group. And the facilitator of that group introduced it by quoting a great quote I've heard before, but I'd forgotten it, from Chogyam Trungpa, the Tibetan Buddhist who founded Naropa University and had an impact on a generation of people. He said, you know, two things about the human condition, some bad news and some good. The bad news is it's as if we were thrown out of an airplane with no parachute. The good news is there's no ground. So. So that, you know, that is a somewhat elusive consolation. To be personal, and I am trying to integrate the personal with the political here. I've jumped out of a couple of airplanes. One was a 30 plus year career as a self-employed leadership coach consultant that had its structure and its rewards. It had the illusion of security, of income, of affirmation, because I felt on average, effective in that role and felt the esteem of a professional community. But I let go of that, along with the income, to work on climate change, my heart is feeling more in line with what I'm doing than it ever did before. But I don't have any of the familiar rewards and security. And at roughly the same time, I just left behind a marriage that is to which I've been committed for most of my adult life. And that's another thing that provided at least the illusion of security. So I'm now trying to learn how to live alone and build a social movement or you know, contribute, you know, some voices to that. And so probably what is has a better chance of being more nourishing to me would be a group that's really more engaged at a personal development, spiritual development level in support of action that we each take elsewhere, but we don't look to one another for tools and techniques. I think that I don't lack, there's lots that I could learn. I know I don't mean to sound arrogant. I feel very humble about what I know, but I'm not sure that I need to know more along those lines in order to do what I need to do. So I'm in. And I'll be curious how what Rick has to say about that, because he's facing some similar challenges, absent the, I don't think he's jumped out of the same airplane. Yeah, Linda, you had a question?
I had a comment, Greg.
Well, Marty, okay.
Because I feel like we're in very similar worlds. You know, maybe what I shared today didn't bring that across, but I mean, my whole focus is on social movements and political work. So I think we are in the same world, but I don't, and I am feeling kind of burnt out right now, so I know that I need to reconstruct within my life some more nourishment around on the personal level too, so that I'm not feeling so burnt out. But to me, I mean, the questions that I am seeking the answer to, in part, I feel everything changed after the election. And everyone that I'm dealing with now is now trying to figure out how to move forward on climate change in a context of a very abnormal political world that we're in. So, and that's part of what my reset is about. And to me, it's really about some key movement questions. I think there's a lot of push right now in the climate movement and in general from the progressive side that we are in a resistance movement. And I, one of the things that I'd really like to discuss with colleagues is, I'm not sure that's the right meme for our movement. I think resistance is something we need to do, but I don't want to hang my whole hat on resistance. I want to be for things and have a reason that I think all people of goodwill that share certain values can come together for many things. So.
Yeah. Well, those are great questions.
Throw that space out there, because to me, these are the kind of real conversations I'm trying to have now with climate groups, with my local peace and justice group, about and the online communities that I'm connected with that are saying we're acting now. I think we're in a very unformed time about how we're going to solidify post-election as a climate movement and as a larger movement for justice and positive change. And so I think the other key theme that I'm thinking about that has to do with movement theory as well is the issue of normalizing. There was just a really interesting article today that's feeding into this. And the idea is, I think we've probably all seen that we should not normalize this moment in our country, that this is abnormal. And I read an article that was from a kind of a neuroscience psychological point of view, kind of creating more of a case even for this, because once you normalize bad behavior, then the spectrum has just been expanded of what's normal, of how bad it can get. And so there's some real fears out right now that in terms of just how our civil discourse and how our organizing, how our communities function, we could suddenly be shifting into a new normal. So to me, how does that translate into my communications as a climate activist and as a citizen around our president-elect is doing things that are bad, or doesn't this strike you as a really abnormal situation that we're suddenly being able to respond in this way? So to me, these are really important questions right now about how we frame and understand the movement that we're in and how we're going to move forward in it.
Yeah, so, well, those are great questions. As I listen, I'm just mindful not to get drawn in, because we haven't heard from Rick or Sarah by way of check-in.
But I didn't want to miss this moment to do that, so forgive me.
Okay.
I guess I'm going to go next, because I think, Sarah, you asked to go last. I should sit down so maybe you get more light on my face. The light here isn't good. I appreciate all of your comments, right back to Jim's. Several of you have commented, I too have been in an uncertain space since the election. I realized that much of what I've been going through feels much like grief, Kubler-Ross, you know, and I have become close buddies. And I can't even predict, you know, like grief, I cannot predict sometimes how I'm going to wake up that day. Some days I'm feeling full of energy and ready to go and ready to continue the effort. And some days, even though I go through the motions, I'm just feeling distracted and down. By the way, I have to, a member of CCL and our co-leader of Elders Climate Action Massachusetts, I have to give a shout out to Judy Weiss, because the best thing that happened to me after the election was meeting at her house on that Wednesday, and we sat Shiva. And I'm not Jewish. It didn't matter. We just sat together in quiet. And it really was the best thing that happened to me in that period.
Wow.
I was struck too by, and maybe some of this comes through this group, ideas for this comes through this group, Jim's comment, and the reason I brought up the name Fred Small, I'll explain in a moment. I think there's a need to be with others who, like always, are on the journey with you to find out what they're working on, how they're feeling. And yes, that's spiritual. Because we're all working in this environment, even if we're working in different ways in very different places. Right now, we're working in the greater context of where the United States is, let alone what's happening to the climate. And I think the ability to find ways to talk with each other, to nurture each other, are going to be important to maintain the will to keep doing the work. I am hoping, this is where my reaction to Jim's comment, I'm hoping that I'm going to have an opportunity perhaps to host a workshop that Fred Small is going to offer. Now, Fred Small is a UU minister. Some of you may know of him because he started off as a folk music, and he has songs and CDs, and that was his first career. Then he became a UU minister, and he worked a lot on rights for the LGBTQ community, wrote songs about it. They were successful. He's been writing songs about the environment. When we show up at protests, and Grady has been in one, at least one, it's like Fred shows up as, and I don't know how to say this because it sounds like I'm trivializing something, but it's the only way I can characterize him. He's a Pete Seeger-like essence at that rally. And that's wonderful. And he is offering a workshop, which I hope to see this year, called Give Light, Spiritual Nurture for Climate Activism. And I don't know, I haven't been through the workshop, so I don't know what he's doing. But I feel like I need some spiritual nurture for climate activism. And I know that as a UU minister, he's not going to be, it's going to be okay from a spiritual nurture point of view. So that's one set of questions. Like Grady, I am struggling with things. I'm still struggling with leaving a career. I've been all involved this week because I am still doing work I care about. I'm working with a group in Africa for the Red Cross right now to design a meeting for next week. It's very all-encompassing, has little to do with the environment other than with the humanitarian issues caused by environmental change. We're just all about organizing a difficult group relative to how they work together for relief. So I'm trying to move and get more time to work on my climate work. I am trying to learn a lot about organizing. Grady is way ahead of me on that scale. But I'm learning too. So some of the things that we're doing, some of the things that I'm trying to experiment with, I think come close to the work of this group. Like, if you're trying to engage a group of people who you're not exactly sure where they're at, relative to their own views of activism and so forth and climate. How much do you go negative? How much do you go positive? You know, so we've got the three stories and the work that reconnects, and I try to build that in. And I'm trying to, but I don't use the word work that reconnects because that's too, too new agey for us. You know, I mean, I'm dealing, you know, you're dealing with a group of elders. One of the interesting things is when I deal with a group of elders, I'm dealing with some people who are very experienced in this area. I can walk into a retirement community and be talking to retired MIT professors like Jay Forrester, who Marty would know, or others. And it's like, these people are no fools, and they've been around for a while. I don't know where all of them are on the climate issue, but most of them are probably supporters, but very few of them are activists. How do I move them to action? What's the conversation? What's the way in? They're not there. Some of them are very much about action, actually. And how do I help them focus and channel and develop that action? And that right now is a wide open question for me. We're doing experiments in ECA. We're talking to different kinds of elders groups. We're doing different kinds of things. And it's probably too early in our experiment. Well, I know for me, it's too early in our experiment to have an answer. But that's continuing to push my learning, and will, I'm sure, for at least the next year or two. Even it gets down to the words we use. I know that a lot of the NCDD exchanges around are right now are around how do you talk to climate deniers. I am not so interested in that. Yes, that comes up from time to time. I am interested in just the conversation about how do you move people forward? How do you move people from complacency, or it's too big, or I can't do anything, towards at least I can do this. I'm going to do that now.
Good question.
So... and I've lost track of our three starting questions. But anyways, so to me, this group, our ability to talk about how we're eating, and I think I'd learned, you know, something from each of you, even though we might be working in different situations, but because we're all working on involving others in climate work, that's important. For example, I'll just give you one little, it may not be relevant. Linda's work relative to, and I don't know much about it, you know, the work of more environmentally sustainable buildings. Well, in Massachusetts, we have a thing around putting, passing legislation related to an environmental seal of approval when you sell a house. This is the rating of this house. And, you know, if you maybe put in, you know, more environmentally sensitive heating and water heating and so forth and so on, you'll get a higher rating on your house, and that'll affect your sales price. Now, that's an idea that's almost got to the floor and got to a vote and got into a bill last year. Didn't quite make it. I hope it will this year. But I know there's a whole range of issues around it. And, you know, so, you know, that's a very tactical example. But, you know, just, you know, I was thinking of that when Linda was talking. It's like, what can we learn from each other across different states? And I do think, like Grady said, I do think the action now is, well, I have for a while, actually. Grady knows this. I think that the leverage in this country comes from the states. It didn't even under the previous, under the Obama administration, affecting change in Washington, partly because of the Republicans there, or maybe mainly because of them, but it was still very, very hard. Even in our own state, our two senators, one's behind environmental issues, the other's otherwise engaged. It's not that she doesn't support them, but that's not her issue. So, you know, you begin to look at, well, what can I do with my state legislature? How can I move that forward? And so that's where my focus is. So I'm in. I think I touched the questions, but I'm not sure.
Okay, I think I'm on. First of all, just I'm glad to meet you all. And thank you, Linda, for inviting me to be here. And I'm trying to understand, you know, my kind of world and work in relationship to what we've been talking about, and many, many things have resonated. As Linda knows, I've been at Clark University for 35 years, and eventually became the head of our Humanities Center. And when I did that, I was lucky pretty quickly to get a grant from the Ford Foundation to create a Difficult Dialogues initiative. And that started about 11 or 12 years ago now. It's a long time. I'm no longer director of the Humanities Centers, but I'm still affiliated with it. And the Dialogue Project is really moved through our whole campus. It's really been an important cultural change, and it's been a practice of how can dialogic thinking, including Bohmian thinking and practice, really strong practice, permeate every aspect of a community of learning and teaching. So in doing that, my own path as a leader in that work and in the Humanities Center took me, I've been interested in our relationship to the natural world my whole life, and my own professional life, certainly, and in my teaching to some extent. And so I got involved with the international group of the Consortium of Humanities Centers on creating a network of centers working on humanities for the environment. You know, what could we do? I mean, we were actually looking for activist angles within the academy at that stage. Eventually, I ended up being able to apply for a project that I'd gotten an inspiration for, literally. I mean, it came in to create a council on the uncertain human future. And this would draw on council practice, way of council, and eventually it became clear it needed to be a group of women, and I did get funded by the Mellon Foundation to do this, and so this was starting, I guess the grant went in 4 years ago at this point, and so this is a project it's a big project, it's actually in has a lot of momentum right now, and I can send you all the website. I think you've seen it, Linda. Is that right? We just released a film, and that's posted on the website, and it is about, and I'm thinking about you, Rick, when you're talking about spiritual nurture for climate activism. This work, this Council on the Uncertain Human Future, is a deep plunge into a reckoning together with a small group in order to really become much more able to work with ourselves, our own struggles, as well as to support each other in what we need to do and be in this world. Never mind this new layer that we've got, which all of it is relevant. All of it's the same in some ways, although God knows it's much worse, it is all the same. Let's just leave it there. I must admit, I'm very stirred up about the current situation or whatever it is. I don't know, it's current. It may be quite long. But and so this work of the council is, there's a national group which includes a number of eminent people, including Mary Catherine Bateson and Kathleen Dean Moore. Several of them have major affiliations with faith-based practices. Mary Evelyn Tucker at Yale, who's been bringing together people around religion and ecology all over the world for the longest possible time. She's in our group. We have a group in Edinburgh who meets at the university there and is, again, interdisciplinary from all over Britain. I just met with, we've just started a new council through one of our original council members at the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder. So these are climate scientists, and we're sitting together in council. And then this has been going on at Clark, and that's, I'll tell you about that in a minute. And there are many other projects that are wanting to be seeded and moved. And I've just received some grant funding to continue these groups that I've started and that are starting. And I'm looking for more seed funding for others. These practices, which are very simple, they're very, you know, it's just way of counsel, sitting in circle, moving the talking piece, using basic prompts, listening from the heart, speaking from the heart, around very simple questions. What is taking place? Why is it happening? What are the implications of these changes? How do we choose to conduct ourselves in the face of these grave dangers? And how do we live now for the world we wish to see? That's the arc of the questions. Sometimes these councils have met in three sessions over the course of a year. Others of them that I'm doing with Clark faculty are meeting in 2-day-long sessions closer together so that we can build that kind of solidarity and depth of awareness that we need in order to do really innovative, important work that we will have the inner ballast for and the inner resources for. And I can tell you from these groups that are happening so far nationally and the Edinburgh group, people become collaborators in a very wonderful way. We have each other's backs. I'm in regular touch with all of these people in a whole variety of ways that include people are writing together. Some people are consulting together. We've gone to the People's Climate March together, but more than that, we are each other's thinking partners, and we're in it for the long haul. And I've told Linda, I think that this is a very, if you really want a group like this one to bond and do deep work together that can have real significance, you need an experience like this to drop into some time together where you can build that and face these things together to a deeper degree. I do want you to know that this work is the basis for a big climate initiative that I'm running at Clark. I mean, a climate change initiative. It's a curriculum initiative. It's something that I've worked on for the last 2 years with about a core team of about 15 faculty members and then a larger group of up to 40 who are involved in trying to bring this kind of awareness, a deep awareness, and spiritual resources, frankly, for our students to the work. Our work is educators, so we're building that at the same time that I'm doing this other council practice. So I can't say too much more, I suppose, without getting into a lot more detail, but those are the general overview or umbrellas of these two projects. You can go online and learn a lot more about the council project, and you can actually sit in this 40-minute film that gives you a feeling for the quality of the conversation that we've had. And there are going to be much more extensive resources posted soon. We filmed all the sessions, and we've had interviews with every member, and those are all going to be posted and available on the website. And then the university project is burgeoning right now. We're seeking major funding, and we have the president's support, and we've developed enough of a common conversation between us that we can do deeper work that will take activist dimensions. But we see creating a form of learning that we're calling collaboratives, where through an initial council process, through dialogue, students and faculty come to identify what it is they think they can work on, do the research together, and then decide how they're going to become activists on that question. So this is becoming a model that we're developing that we hope we will have eventually 8 or 10 of these going at any given time on our small campus. So anyway, I hope that's helpful. I feel as though as far as this group goes, I would like to be a resource. This council practice is just, you know, you're talking about the elder climate action groups, you know. I think that this kind of practice is very valuable when you're trying to build the capacities for people to act together. And so as a simple practice that could happen in short sessions in a community, it could definitely be created in that way, modified to function in that way. It can function in all kinds of community groups. We're talking about in Edinburgh, they're talking about taking it into the military. I mean, Scotland is different, you know. Things can happen there that couldn't happen elsewhere. And they're thinking about taking it into civic organizations and definitely faith-based organizations as a practice. So anyway, I would say I'd just be happy to answer any questions that anybody has about that project in particular, and that practice in particular, you know, now or later, you know, on offline or in email or in a call. And, you know, I have to say I've got a lot of commitments, so I'm not sure how this group would function for me. And I just want to be open to thinking about that. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow. Could you put your website on our little list here, Sarah? That would be helpful.
Yeah. Where is the list?
Yeah, we may not have explained that. Would you... Well, I don't know that we want to go into that.
I'll figure it out afterwards, Linda.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah. That's fine. You know, I mean, this could be a process that this kitchen group would want to go through. I would just like to observe also that getting back to one of Grady's comments about how you motivate people for action, the limit, I mean, most of my work now is with those that have already somewhat cross the boundary of fire, and so they're in. To me, there's kind of a boundary of fire where you can be aware and you can be suffering and you can know the world's that we got to do something, but you haven't yet crossed this boundary of fire where you know that this is part of your work in life, and so how do you help people cross that boundary? But I'm working mainly with people that have already crossed the boundary who are struggling with questions. But Grady, I think, is trying to build a movement of people who haven't yet crossed that boundary. And in my limited experience of public speaking and of outreach and engagement, giving people ways to have personal experiential moments is really one way that I've seen that helps them cross that boundary. So this way of the Council on the Uncertain Human Future, wow. That sounds like a powerful process. And I don't know how long it takes to go through the whole series of prompts.
You can do it in different modalities. Yeah. You can do it in shorter or longer ways. I've done it with students in shorter 3-hour or 2-hour sessions that meet more often. So you can modify it. There are ideal ways and then there are modified ways.
I'm actually wondering on that same question, Sarah, is your council process that you're using, would it be applicable, say, to an elder group, like going into like Rick was saying, going into like a, you know, an elder residence, or into like a faith-based group, you know, where they're not really all sold on climate change as being necessarily an issue?
Oh, yeah, it isn't appropriate unless people are ready for it. It's not, it would have to be people who voluntarily entered the conversation. It's not appropriate if people aren't ready to look deeply Yeah. So in that way, it's not an introductory process.
Right. Okay.
So it's, you have to be
committed to action. I'm sorry. I should, who's facilitating? What's our process? We raise our hands or?
Oh, so facilitating this, yeah.
Yeah, we're all kind of facilitating. Nobody really is. But so, yeah, just raise your hand. Go ahead, Grady.
I think the people that Rick and I are working with, though, Sarah, are actually have crossed the threshold in terms of believing that climate change is a problem and that it's human caused. The threshold they haven't crossed is feeling the need to put it at the top of their priority list and actually get out of their comfort zone to do something. You know, write a congressperson, join a march, write a letter to the editor, things like that. So I think the notion of an experiential, you know, aha moment, if we could create those opportunities, I think that could be powerfully motivating for some of the folks we show up with. Mm-hmm. So,
I think what I really am noticing from listening to all of us, and your going last was perfect, Sarah, because in a sense, you know, I think many of us are seeing from our work that when you don't spend that time up front, you even said this to me when we had lunch, when you don't spend that deep dive time up front with people and you really get to know them personally, then it's hard to sustain the work no matter what it is, because I mean there's so many ways to do climate change work. When I first started, I would try to think of it strategically and I couldn't do it because there's just so many ways you can do climate change work. Everything from just, you know, growing your own garden and putting solar on your own house to doing policy and legislative things. I mean, there's so many different ways of doing climate change work. So to motivate people, it's, I find personally, I'm just really discovering this just recently as I look at my own crossroads, it's the relationships I have with other people that are driving me forward. In other words, where I feel connected in with the people that I'm working with, suddenly that becomes the path I want to go down, not because it's more strategic, because it's going to make more of an impact in my community. It's more like, yeah, I'm having fun there and I'm feeling engaged with those people. So there's something about what you're saying, Sarah, that I think is at root in all of our work. If we're going to stay nurtured, if we're going to stay excited about our work, even with all the political stuff that's going on, we've got to have that, we've got to find ways to build the relational foundation. And I just want to get this off my chest. I was on a call last night with a group in Vermont. It's a Bernie group. It's the We the People group, Marty, that I've been kind of, I'm on their advisory panel now or whatever. And they wanted me to do some team building. So they were supposed to have like 20 people there, and maybe there were 9. It wasn't nearly the 20 people that they had said. And I was given 7 minutes to talk about dialogue and then given about another 20 to 30 minutes to bring them into some kind of relationship process. And it was nuts. We weren't going to do anything like that. And then they went right back into their organizing behaviors. It's an organizing group. And I thought to myself, wow, no wonder that group isn't getting off the ground. They never take the time to do the deeper dive with each other. So I don't know. It's such a dichotomy, such a paradox, that we're in the midst of this huge emergency, this huge environmental emergency that we ourselves have created, and yet, there's on the one hand, we don't have time to build relationships. On the other hand, if we don't build the relationships, we'll never get the work done in the long haul. So I just find that so remarkable. I'm done for now.
You know, I just want to bring up, this is jumping a little bit, if we're just kind of now having a conversation off of what we heard, I think this Council on the Uncertain Human Future sounds like a powerful tool and important to this work. But another resource that Grady might not have heard of and might interest Rick is Henry Hahn's book, and I forget the name of it. Do you know about her name is, I'll send the link out.
Yeah, she presented to a monthly meeting of the Citizens Climate Lobby.
I read her book, and the way that Mark Reynolds and others in CCL interpreted what she had to offer was not what I took away from it at all. There was some deeper logic there about relationships and the role of, it's really about sustaining chapters and more sustaining your committees once you've got them started to be gelled. But there was some real wisdom in that book about organizing that I found. So I would, and I actually made a little summary of the book.
I'd love to see it. I was impressed with her presentation. It sounded like very good work, and it is certainly relevant to Linda's comment about the importance of relationships. The course that I took last spring that some of you know about with Marshall Gantz at the Kennedy School at Harvard emphasized the critical role of one-on-one relationships as the foundation for groups that stay together.
And she's a protege of Marshall Gantz, you know, that's who she studied under. So, Henry,
Oh, she did, huh?
Yes, that was her mentor. Marshall Gantz.
Small world.
That's of interest to me. I think the one thing that Katie, this woman that I'm working with in Vermont, who does the progressive work, she is very good at doing one-on-ones, although I don't think she ever did one with you, Marty. For some weird reason, we didn't get you in that loop. But she's good at that. She pulls people in that way. But I don't see her doing the group thing. I don't see her making the connections. And so I'm kind of curious what, I didn't get the name. Is it Harriet Hahn?
It's Henry. It's H-A-N-R-I-E. Henry Hahn. And I forget the name of the book. It's got activist in the title. But
So I'm curious if she talks at all about, once you do the one-on-one relationship building, does she talk about how she does relationship building in groups at all to keep them... Cemented.
Yeah. I mean, one of her premises, and it was actually, Linda, you just said something that reminded me about it. You said, you know, that where you find yourself called is where you like the people or where you feel you can have fun. She tells a story in her book of there was a woman who was working for a pro-life group, and she was out at the picket line in front of a clinic every day working for this pro-life group. And, she got recruited in by accident. She had been pro-choice, but she had heard about a meeting and didn't really know what it was about. She dropped in, really liked the people, and she ended up working for this pro-life group. So she makes it a little more credible than the nutshell I just put around it. But her whole point is that the relationships and the way a group operates to keep its members empowered and engaged is critical. And it's a chemistry. The leader's chemistry is how you make that happen through relationships.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. So I guess I do still have a question, Sarah. So on your website, do you actually give formats in your questions, and you kind of help? I mean, would there be process content there if we looked?
What I have is two practice guides, one for members and one for conveners, but they are both need to be updated. And so the basic website has the basic questions, the prompts, and it has a basic introduction to council practice. And what I do now is I craft agendas for each meeting. Of whatever council I'm involved with, and then the Edinburgh group does their own because we've worked together. So right now it's a kind of a customized process, and I think it's wise for it always to be. But you will find practice guides that are on the website. I just think they're not quite where they should be.
Yeah.
And actually, now that I'm thinking about it, they might not be on that website. They might be on the Higgins School website. I'll have to look and see. But there's a lot of information that's on the current site about process. And then, as I say, what I've assumed and this has always been the case, is that I work with each person who's doing this. Mm-hmm. And as it happens, I'm very often there also. Like, I just, my colleague facilitated the one at NCAR, but I was a witness. I was part of it. And then gave her feedback all the way through it. You know, just as that's sort of a typical practice in council, is that there might be a witness as part of the process.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. Yeah, it sounds really like it should be something that should go viral to other schools.
Well, to every kind of place. It doesn't have to just be schools at all. You know, like NCAR is a government agency. Hmm.
Well, I really like what you said. It's going to stick with me. How it sounds like your council process, and of course, this is just good dialogue practice anyways, doesn't necessarily have as its goal action, correct? I mean, you don't come together and say, we're going to come, you know, we're going to join together and go do something. You come together in deep conversation, and out of that, the relationships themselves might result into some action.
That's it really, it's very much, you know, what Marty was saying. Let's slow down and challenge our assumptions. You know, you start at the beginning and with that deep common plunge with each other. And then very, it is a very emergent process that some real things that need to happen emerge from that. This doesn't say it has a solution. In fact, it says that this kind of listening together is a solution in itself. Yeah. You know, it is the beginning of being able to really alter the way we are behaving, right? To interrupt it. You'll see a lot of this content in the films that we're posting, both the initial one, the short one, but then the detailed ones in the interviews. A lot of people will say things about what's needed now in different ways. But certainly, I mean, there's so many things that are needed now, and we speak, you know, people speak to a whole wide range of those that include very much, you know, political action, social action, but a lot of it is an internal process, right? It's our relationship to ourselves, and our relationships to each other, and to the planet, especially, and really being with that in a new way. And it's so hard. I mean, it's as hard as the situation we're in politically right now. We know that we're not going to have anything happen fast. And we have, you know, we are really on the spot, I think, spiritually, to deal with this well. Yeah, it's one of the hardest things I think humans have ever had to do. Both of these things, this political situation and the climate.
Yeah.
I can't imagine any humans have had to do anything this hard.
No. I think that maybe the Native Americans did.
Well, they are still doing.
Well, they saw it coming, and many lived through the extermination of their civilization consciously.
You're right. It has happened before. It has happened before. Yeah. This, the fact that it's the whole planet, though.
That's right. There's a little difference in scale. Yeah. Well, this is.
Are you going to speak, Marty?
No.
I was just a follow-up, just my reflection that, you know, I'm thinking about in the group that, you know, Grady and I are part of. One of the things that I value in that group is that it's a group of people who are activists to certain degrees. They vary in their activism, but they all come with different sets of experiences, hence their elders. Some of them have been lawyers for their whole career. Some of them have been engineers and so forth and so on. And I value that. It's a great resource. And yet it's hard for us at times to make decisions, to move past or integrate different kinds of expertise when that person's expertise says, this must be so in our actions. And somebody else says, yes, but it can't be that way if we're going to leverage this or do that in the political environment or whatever. we don't have a good way to work that through. Whether we could all hold them, we could hold them all in a council process, whether they would buy into that, I don't know, but it's work that would be helpful to this, just speaking of one group, one particular node, if you will, on a network of networks that we need going forward to change the climate.
I think you hit on it, Rick. That actually is one of the biggest questions I have in my own life and work going forward is, you know, it's easy to bring people into a training on dialogue because they want to be there. But it's not so easy to work with a group of activists who have decided, wow, we want to get something done around climate. And no, we don't want to sit and talk aimlessly, what looks like aimless talk. So that's one of the biggest questions I have is, and I think that's why I'm so curious, Sarah, about your work, because I think perhaps in a university setting or in a setting where they know they're going to be taking a deep dive. I mean, you're telling them they're taking a deep dive, right? They're not really coming together to do activist work.
Yeah, but you know, Linda, I would just say, I mean, the first group, you realize I reached out to people who had long histories of major work of various kinds in this area, and they were so eager for this conversation. Mm-hmm. It wasn't, don't limit it to the idea that it's in a university context or that, you know, and remember, we only, I mean, I admit that I do cajole my colleagues at the university to do this. I mean, there's the first group that was ready, and then I keep cultivating them because that's my prerogative as a senior faculty person, you know. But other than that, we don't cajole people to come to be part of these. People are ready. They are eager. They are yearning is what I, you know, I really want you to feel that. People are yearning for contact with each other around something that we all know is devastating and that we don't know how to face. And so it is not my, you know, having to figure out how to get them there. If anything, as soon as they heard it, the invitation, the first group, they were right there. What I find in my own community here in Worthington, and this is spreading now because the film is there, and so it's kind of emerging, and also before that, people hear about it, and they want to know more, and they want to know how they can do it. And it's something about how difficult the situation is that people know that we've got to do it differently. We need each other desperately, you know, and this is a means by which we can build the kind of community and solidarity that we're going to need.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's interesting because I think the DD community as a whole has worked in so many different ways. And this is definitely, it starts as a process of reflection rather than action. But our problem is that we've got to start at the beginning. You know, we have to question our assumptions. We have to get people to slow down.
Yeah. Well, you're inspiring me. I one thing I don't think I've even told you, Marty, I haven't mentioned it on the call. I finally, in addressing my own depression after the election, I went on this cruise with the nation and with a couple that's from my community. And they're all jazzed up now to support me in starting a true dialogue group in my Tubac community, my little art, you know, village. So I don't know who's going to show up, but I've got, you know, I've barely put it out there. And so far I've got at least 10 people and my little place will only hold about 20. So I'm on my way. So we'll see. I people do seem to be hungry. You're right. For just conversation. Cause that's all I'm saying. I say, this is just a conversational group. We're just going to talk about issues that are urgent right now, like climate change. I've named climate change. So we'll see.
Linda, can I just mention one quick thing? Mm-hmm. Sorry, Grady. I'll be really fast. I would really urge you to pay really, I mean, it's silly to say this to you of all people with all your process background, but I would be just so careful to try to be sure that you use some way in which people can each weigh in and know that, use a council-like beginning at least.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Because it changes everything, as you know.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, I have two thoughts just listening to Sarah talk about her great work. One is that among the things that I said in my check-in was that I was looking for a way to integrate the spiritual with the political. It sounds to me, Sarah, like your process does that in a way. You're encouraging people to reflect on their relationships to one another and to the earth. I think, I see, this is not a unique insight, but I see the climate crisis as a relatively superficial reflection of more deeply rooted cultural problems and patterns. And it sounds like your process has the potential to address that while not ignoring action, although it sounds like there's maybe some tension, how fast you can go, what it will result in. But also the other thought I have as I listen is that although Rick and I in particular, and there is at least one more person in the group, two more, who bring a lot of process experience and expertise. I don't know that, I can't say that we've really integrated a lot of that into our meetings. They're so time constrained, a couple of hours once a month is about all we can, we did one retreat, but even that, it just seemed like there's too much to do, too little time, and many of the things, like just agreeing on ground rules that I would have seen as best practice in my career, my professional work, that kind of gets left on the cutting room floor as we figure out what we've got time for. And so I've got no one to blame other than my own limitations. But this issue has come up more than once. How do you balance task and relationship? It's a classic polarity. I think we may be erring on the side of task orientation as we struggle to stay engaged and try to provide people a platform for feeling like they're doing something.
Yeah, I've done the most miserable facilitation of my life as a chapter leader in Citizens. It's like I don't even recognize the person anymore. And all the time, a trainer too in facilitation. And I just have been so smug over the years telling all of these managers and senior people in-house getting trained in my methods that, yeah, you just switch hats, You wear your leader hat and your facilitator hat and you just switch them. And, and now that I'm having to live it, it's become just very messy trying to, and to process needs and knowing all of those needs and yet also provide leadership, which is a content expert role, and make sure things get done, that at the end of a meeting we're moving into action. So it's these are not easy.
I agree. I too have been guilty, and the only thing that lets me a little off the hook is I remember in graduate school, and I went to school in adult education and instructional design, and I had some great faculty, but for example, the worst designed course was the course taught by the faculty member who led
in design.
Yeah, we can't get out of our own way when we're responsible for it,
Yep. The neurotic psychiatrist is a paradigm for many professions.
Well, if you figure we're attracted to what we most need to, learn, we're probably all the worst process people.
It makes sense.
It's ironic. But we also know a lot, and we're also sensitized, to it. So we're also our own worst judges, of course.
Yes, the only thing that redeems me from committing the errors that I used to coach people on trying to avoid is that I'm humble about it. And no illusion that I'm doing any better than I'm doing. Well, I wonder where we are as we look at the clock.
Well, there's really only one other question that we wanted to deal with. I think we've talked about, what would nurture us. And Sarah, if I heard you right, you're thinking that you'd want to be more a resource and not in the group.
I can't really tell, Linda.
you want to just sit with it for a while?
Yeah, I mean, I love being here, and I'm very, I don't have a group of colleagues of this sort in my life, but I'm also pretty flat out in terms of the things I'm responsible for. So I don't want to. I just am not quite sure where I fit in exactly. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think we're all feeling that way. I mean, this has to work for all of us, and we don't know exactly. We're in uncharted territory ourselves here because we don't even know, how do we want to run this group? We just knew Marty and the couple of four of us that were doing it before. We just knew that we didn't want to run the group. We wanted all of us to run the group and to have a shared process that would emerge. So, all I can say is, we'd love to have you and, hang in as much as you can. We'll keep, do we want to meet more than once a month? I know for myself, it's like I want to, but I'm also doing so many other things. So for me, a once a month, 2-hour group would probably fit. How did the rest of you feel?
I wouldn't want to meet more often than that.
Yeah, and I think we had thought that maybe those different people could, for example, Sarah could come next time and say, I'm going to give you a taste. We're going to spend a little time and get a taste of the council. And then there could be time for just letting our hair down. I mean, I feel like we did a little bit of that today without even knowing each other that well. I mean, I think that's really, aside from being exposed to new resources and new ideas, there's many things I want to follow up from this call. I think I really want a place where I can drop all my roles that I'm playing in terms of trying to get things, make things happen, and just let my hair down and use. So I think there's a support function here that, may not be a need other people have, but I also feel very inspired that I want to be a resource to all of, to whoever else is in this group, to support, to share knowledge or ideas or people that I know that maybe other people need to connect to. So I'd like to meet monthly and just give it a little more time and see what happens. Other thoughts from others?
I think monthly is right. Every other month would be too infrequent to maintain connection.
Mm-hmm.
But monthly's about right.
Cool.
And of course, I'm always encouraged. I mean, there's four of us that are in the Massachusetts area. We include Jim and Sarah and Grady and me.
Yeah,
I just want us to get together and have coffee, but that's not what we're here to do.
Those of us elsewhere will feel sad.
Yeah, right. But that obviously, if you can meet you should. So I'm just feeling, I'll just throw this out in terms of our process, that if we just kept it loose, we do our check-ins, and I agree, Marty. I mean, if there's something that we all say, oh, let's for sure do, following time, we can do it. But I think I would always want to have, a deep check-in as we begin. And I think out of the check-in, probably we'll come up with some kind of framing question. It happened almost automatically this time. So I'm assuming it would happen when we meet in the future. And of course, having said that, I think we are quite interested in learning more, Sarah, about your council. So maybe that is something we can do at a certain point. You could maybe prepare a little something for us and we could see how, and maybe it would even be useful for you to, maybe you have some questions or you want to share with us something that you're about ready to launch or something, we could learn from you and also provide some feedback. I don't know, just a thought.
Well, I think that, I'm just hoping that you'll, you'll look at the website in the film. And that may be an awful lot for you, and you might not feel that, you know, I'd be happy to answer questions if that would be useful. But I think you all, given how much experience you've had, the film and the website are going to give you a lot of orientation. And then I'm here and happy to talk. Right. Yeah.
Cool. So does that sound like enough structure just to do check-ins and just allow something to emerge out of that that we dialogue on?
It may do, because we don't know how fast things are going to be changing around us.
Yeah.
And different ones of us may be encountering, hopefully, some successes and other challenges, and we may need to spend time with that too.
Right.
Yeah.
But I think if we just keep it emergent, that way we can all bring whatever is juicy for us in the moment, you know, to our meetings with each other. At least that would be how I would love to see it. So yes.
That's good.
Cool. Well, any other thoughts, or are we done?
I think so. Linda, could you just review for others who may or may not know? I think there's maybe three other people who might join at another call that weren't able to make this call. Is that correct?
Yes. So let me go over that, see if I can remember it all. So Rosa was very sorry she couldn't join us. She's definitely in the group. Rosa Zubirata. I know. I think you all know her. Barbara Simonetti wants to be in the group. However, she just shared with me that she's going to Africa and she doesn't know when she's going to be back. She has an open-ended ticket. She and her husband are going on a retirement trip and they may be gone as long as through the end of, I think she said March. So she won't be with us for a while, but she is quite interested in joining the group. Oh, I know there's other people. Sue Blythe might join us. She wanted to be part of the group at the last minute, and I welcomed her, and then I just caught something on my email before I jumped in that she couldn't be on today. Who else was going to be on? I know there's a couple of other people.
What about Mike, the other Mike, the guy that was into the interfaith work? What was his name, Mike?
Yes, he wants to be the group, and I don't know where he is. I've never heard back from him. I'll follow up with him.
Okay. Well, that's fine. I mean, yeah. I think you can. To me, this size felt pretty good to me, actually. This mm-hmm. size is a little bit larger.
Right.
Linda, can I ask a question? It sounds like a lot of the people in this group are Massachusetts-based. Is that true?
It seems to be. I don't know why. It just worked out that way.
Just saying that if we wanted, you know, like I'd be happy to host something at Clark if we could get those of you who are far flung to, you know, come, we could have a gathering at Clark.
Yeah.
Or if there's some place that those of you who are further in toward Boston want to do, but I have nice facilities at Clark.
Oh, the other lady, Sharon Joy Kleit, she couldn't be with us. She was one of our co-hosts. She's in the group. She's in Florida.
Okay.
Rosa is in Massachusetts. Yeah, Rosa's in Western Mass.
You're Rosa right. And Barbara are both in Massachusetts. And then are there three of us, Rick and Grady and Jim?
Jim is in Southern New Hampshire. He's an expert.
He might as well be here.
Right.
You're right.
Us. That's a lot of us.
Yeah, it is. Is anybody going to the climate march in April in D.C.?
I am.
Yeah.
Yes. I think a number of people from Elders Climate Action are going.
Because well, so I'm considering going there. I don't know. And I'm trying to think of ways to make that manifold valuable. For example, I definitely want to do some lobbying while I'm there. I'm not sure it's going to be straight with this climate lobby. It might be I think I might want a little bit freer rein, but I'm really kind of still contemplating it. My good news is I think I have a place to stay, so I don't have to worry about lodging, and I don't have to quite commit, but that all of you, so many of you are thinking of going, I'd just like to put that in the hopper for us to think about as well, because like I said, if I go, I want to make it a time to maximize connections and ties that can support me and support this work.
Well, Well, right, it looks like we're all, I haven't actually been personally planning to go, but if all of you are going, I would make an effort to go. And like you, I would just find other things I can attach to the trip. So why don't we tentatively think about that? That would be an awesome.
Yeah, let's bring it up again next month. And Sarah, what are you? Who are you going with? And under what auspice?
Well, I'm going with my husband, but my problem is that I may have the National Council may be partly convening in front or behind it. So it might be a little bit of a complicated time for me, but it might not. I might just be there. What I've thought about is I don't have a facility there that is a place where we can have a longer meeting, and I couldn't think of any place. So
possibly find a place. I mean, I know some organizations there that might give us a room. I mean, you're talking about.
Okay. Yes. Yeah.
Well, let's definitely talk about, let's put that on the agenda then. In fact, when I send out the, the next meeting time, I'll even mention that so we can all just be thinking about it and maybe bring ideas for how we could put something like that together. Mm-hmm. That'd be awesome.
It would be good, too, to talk a little bit about how it backs up to, because I'm aware that there are multiple activities that weekend and Monday and Tuesday. So we'll need to figure out where's the opportunity for us to come together. You know, it's Tuesday afternoon, it's Tuesday morning, it's
well, we'd have to
Sunday afternoon, it's something, you know, I don't
know. Yeah, just so you know, Elders Climate Action is organizing a national day, 2 days actually, on that Monday and Tuesday, May 1st and 2nd. So we structured it around the march. On that Sunday, I'm sorry?
On the hill? You're going on the hill, you mean?
Well, one of those days is going to be a kind of a lobby day, and the other is going to be a conference where we do training and discussion. And then on Sunday, an organization that's led by one of our members, Adam Sachs, Biodiversity for Livable Climate, is thinking of doing a conference. So there is a lot going on.
Is this on the
various ones may be pulled away?
What day is it on? I know I put it on my calendar, but I'm not sure. I don't remember
it's
where.
It's the 29th, I believe. April.
It's Saturday, April 29th.
And so Sunday would be this conference. Is that an open conference that people?
The biodiversity conference is open, and this group has had about half a dozen of those in the last several years. They're very. I've been to one of them. I think they're good. Certainly the Elders Climate Action conference is open for anybody who's.
And that's going to be before the march?
No, after Monday and Tuesday of the following week.
Could you send us something on those things so we can all kind of be looking at it?
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
Sure.
Awesome, sure. Awesome. Well, that's really cool. That's far enough away that we can plan perhaps for it. And I think, you know, like we've been suggesting, if we could kick our own process off with some real good face-to-face time, it could only serve us all, you know. So that feels really good.
Right.
I'm a little concerned, Linda, that this march is going to be very overloaded with other constraints. I mean, I have my own possible ones, but I'm just worried we wouldn't get a nice quiet time together. We'd have to really work to carve it out. I don't know if we could find it, but we could try.
I agree.
Yeah, so
it's probably true.
Let's think about it, and I'm going to look a little more closely at my schedule and see what kind of time I could commit to be in D.C. And I don't know, Sarah, when you don't know yet whether it's before or after the march that your council activities
is starting to be discussed. So it's not clear at all.
Well, let's just all hold it lightly right now, get as much information as we can, and then maybe regroup around it next time.
And I'm going to build in time to go to the African American Museum, which sounds worthwhile.
Yes, I've heard that's an amazing place now. Well, okay. Thank you, Marty, for that. That I'm going to go off to this meeting. I'm supposed to be meeting all kinds of, I don't know, elected officials who are in Arizona. It's supposed to be a networking thing, and I made a special trip to Phoenix. So thank you. That's value of the network. I wouldn't have even known about it had you not sent that to me. So thank you. Anything else anybody wants to say?
Just one thing, Sarah, did you put your website information somewhere where we can find it?
I am going to. As soon as we sign off, I will go find where I need to put it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
The at the best, I will send it to our email. I'll send it to Linda and she can send it to the email list.
Okay.
Cool. I'll send it to the list she sent it to. Yeah.
Okay. Great.
All right. And I'll get this this Zoom recording put up on KikoChat. And sometimes, Sarah, I'll walk you through KikoChat and give you more of a sense. Maybe we can make an appointment. That way you'll know.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
All right. Thank you, guys. Wonderful you. To be on this call with you. See you next month.
That's great. All Thanks right. so much, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Take care.